FastlyPy Private Limited. FastlyPy is an open source education technology company working in the industry since 2015. FastlyPy identified the gap between the industry and the academia and started providing solutions by conducting workshops, seminars, and student development programs for nourishing the student skill set, which is now taking them closer to their aspiring career. FastlyPy has trained more than 38,000 students and 1,500 faculties as per industry standards. I would now like to invite our head of department, Megha Ma'am, to give us an insight on today's workshop. Over to you, Megha Ma'am.
Good afternoon. I welcome all participants to workshop on Docker organized under the Aegis of Star College scheme in association with FastlyPy Private Limited. We have organized many workshops with FastlyPy in the past, and I really thank them for accepting our invitation for this workshop. Today, developers, programmers need their applications to run anywhere, anytime, but with seamless integration and connectivity. Docker is one of the solutions for that. Docker is a set of platform as a service products that uses operating system virtualization to deliver software in packages called containers. The main goal of this workshop is to cover basic concepts of Docker, understand its working, and build small application using it. I hope that all will be well equipped after the workshop to develop many more Docker-based applications. Have a great learning. Over to you, Ria.
Thank you, ma'am. We shall now move on to introducing our speaker and trainer for this workshop. Mr. Zafar Sir has completed his engineering from National Institute of Technology, Raipur. He has industry experience for more than 5 years. He has worked in Infosys as system engineer and is currently working as senior software developer and solution architect at Kalsa Technologies, Mumbai. He has expertise in backend programming, web technology, analyzing the security of websites, and API development. It is our utmost honor to have you conducting this workshop, sir. A small reminder before we officially start with the proceedings. Participants, please keep in mind that you have to fill the attendance form as well as the feedback form for today, which will be pasted in the chat. I now request Zafar sir to take over and begin the workshop. Thank you.
Thanks, Ria. And it's great honor for me to organize such a good workshop for your college. And the topic that is Docker, so it's quite interesting and very useful topic. And I'm too glad to your college that you chosen such an important topic that is one of the backbone in the industry in the managing and deployment on overall life cycle of application. So I'm just sharing my screen. So in today's topic, we are going to cover a few things. So today we have 3 hours session and for tomorrow it is 4 hours. So mainly in today, we are covering most of the theoretical and some practicals. Okay. And the tomorrow is purely practicals and some industry-based application we are going to host the way we are actually host in the industry. We use the same process in the current industries. Okay. So in this session, means today's session, we are going to learn about what is Docker. And definitely if it is something you want to learn, you have to know the background and why you are using. And about the containers, like what Docker is actually managed underlying. So basically Docker manages containers. So entire life cycle of containers is managed by Docker. So we learn about containers and then we move with Docker containerization versus virtual machine. So you already aware, most of the people, I think you guys are aware of virtual machines. So we understand what is the difference between both and why industry opt Docker containerization over virtual machine. And So coming to the Docker, if something we learn about things, so we must know where we actually live our containers and where it actually exists. Okay. So yeah, so that is repositories, talking about repository, Docker Hub, something where you store your image, pull your image, something like that. And coming to the practical session, then we come to Docker installation. Maybe you, most of people are familiar with Ubuntu or a Windows operating-based operating system. We actually perform the installation on Ubuntu-based operating system. And if you don't have the setup, don't worry. We can use the playground. Some online playground is available for us, given provided by the Docker itself. We can use the, we can do the hands-on there. And then we create a simple, so we actually going to use Docker Hello World Flow and understand the how it actually works internally. Basic, mainly we understand the Docker architecture. Idea behind this is you have to be familiar with architecture, how Docker works internally. Okay, so that you have a, you know, a basic concept, you have a good basic concept. I know it's very difficult to understand the architecture at this stage, but yeah, you have to be, you have some basic clarity at least. And then we actually containerize a simple Python program or some simple Python script so that you can use in a daily basis. You definitely, you write lot many programs in daily basis. You can containerize those Python or that application. Okay. So then we understand the Docker file, that is the backbone of all the Docker components. Basically, it actually have the instructions written over the Docker. So whatever the Docker actually perform the steps is actually written over the Docker file. That instructions is coming so from Docker file. So we Docker actually use as a reference. So whatever things it actually performs, it actually take the reference from Docker file itself. So we learn how to write Docker file because it's the most important thing to deploy your application in the Docker, because you need to know what are the syntax to write the Docker file. That's, and we learned about basic Docker commands. That is huge, means almost it covers 75 to 80%, mainly as per I, so whatever, as per my experience, I almost try to cover 70 to 80% of commands that is useful and that is used in the industry. And then we host a simple sample Flask based application and push image to Docker Hub. And we actually perform different tasks as well. I hope you enjoy the session. And then finally, I give an assignment. You can, I provide you the solution and I discuss over the assignment by tomorrow session. And on tomorrow session, we have a pure practical session and we learn we are trying to be pro in Docker, means hands-on. So try to understand the theory very well, because through this you can able to imagine the whole thing, what's going on. Okay so coming back to the topic, Docker. So anyone is familiar with Docker, what it is, or heard about term Docker? Anyone? You can put your comments on the chat. Okay, so Rohit Salve, can you briefly explain what you understand by Docker, what it actually do? Means what kind of problems it solves, why it come into the picture? Means why industry adopt, means why it is like, why industry opt Docker's as a, you know, it's a, you know, it's a basically, so anyone has idea about Docker basic, or shall we start? Shall I start? Okay. So Docker is something like, it's just a piece of code or software platform. And it is based on containers, or you can use, or you can say it is a tool designed to make it easier to create, deploy, and run application by using containers. So I'll get back to you about containers, what it is. Okay. So Docker enables you to separate your application from your infrastructure, so you can deliver software quickly. So yeah. So the major challenge about in the real industry is deploying your code in the production environment. So that leads a lot more time, because we have to go with SDLC lifecycle, and it comes with, let's say you done with your application coding, then you perform the testing, and then you have a QA process, qualitative analysis process, and then you have to basically deploy your, after QA is done, you have to deploy your application on the production. And that's that's why Docker comes into the picture to deploy your application in very smoothly, so that it can basically helps you in the industry, like to a smooth integration or deployment of your application in the production environment, or any environment you can say. And also it very easy to maintain the life cycle of the application through Docker. Okay, I'll just cover all those points, why it is, how it actually helps. So coming back to the topic Docker, what it is. So it is actually a open source project launched in 2013, helped popularize the technology, and has helped drive the trends towards containerization and microservice software development. Don't worry, I'll get back to you about the microservice trends that actually use in the industry. Maybe by tomorrow you are familiar with microservice, what it is, and how it is helpful in the industry. Basically, industry, all of the application are based going to towards microservice rather than monolithic. Currently, in the older platforms or older version, we have monolithic application architecture where everything is hosted at the same machine. But there is new trend, microservice. Actually, it helps in deploying your application in a smoother way, and it actually decoupled your application. Means for every component of your application, there is separate service altogether. So we learned about also in the container session or Docker session. Okay. So the new technology, this is not very old. Okay. Well, not a new technology actually, but a new way of implementation got a lot of attraction in the open source community, and many major players in the industry adopted it as a part of their upcoming projects. Okay, so many major player means Google, Microsoft, Amazon. How many of you wants to go to Google or wants to hire, go for Google or wants to place on Amazon or something like that? Everyone, right? So everyone wants to go that kind of wants that kind of opportunities, right? So yeah, so so that organization actually accepts this technology called Docker. So the attraction gained by this open source product was so high that it becomes the most popular in packaging application inside a container, and has become the hottest trend in application development. And you can say deployment testing, means in the month's release, you can say everyone actually tried to acquire Docker in their project for the deployment or overall life cycle of the application. So coming to the question, why Docker, how it actually solves all these problems. So first we need to understand what are the problems, okay, and what kind of problems that actually solve. Because since you are very initial stage, I also go with that stage where we are not aware of industrial problems. What are the problems in the industry usually faced while development or deployment of projects? Okay, so it's simple, like you build an application that does something, and you want to host something somewhere so that it actually serves the request of the clients, right? Application does this thing, right? So Docker solves one of the main problems in the software industry that system administrator and developer faced for years. So what it is, that is, it was working on somewhere, but it is not working on some another machine. So it might be sometimes it happens like same code is running on developer machine and same code is not working on QA machine, or you can say tester, the guy who actually testing the whole flow. Okay, so but why it is and also it is not working on production. So in the meantime, when we are going to live the system and something breaks, right? Well, the problem, yeah.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Can you share your screen?
It is not shared. Yeah. Sorry, maybe it is. Okay. So currently I am on the same page. Why, Docker? Okay. So I am I'm actually discussing about the problems. Well, the problem most of the time can be why this problem occurs, working on the machine, some machine, and working same code is not working on another machine. So most of the time it can be a version mismatch of some library or few packages not being installed. What is packages and what is libraries? Okay, so it is something like, you can say, dependencies. Let's say you want to run Python, you want to run some program on, let's say, languages Python or Java. So you need some sort of classes or dependency that already built by someone, right? So, and you actually use those modules. That's the whole point of modularizing the application or packaging it, right? So you can directly reuse the same package. No need to develop from the scratch. That's the thing. So that is called libraries that actually use in your current application that you use in day-to-day applications. So sometimes what happens is version mismatch issue. I'm taking an example. Let's say you have some component X installed on both the machine, tester and developer both, and tester has some version x 1.2 and developer has version, let's say it has he has the latest version 1.5 or something. Okay, but some another library, that is Y, okay, and that is not compatible with x version 1.2 because since it's an older version, okay, and it is compatible with X version 1.5 or above. Okay, so that is the actually day-to-day we face these issues usually. Okay, every time we find a version mismatch conflict. Okay, so this is where Docker steps in and solve this problem forever by making an image of an entire application with all its dependencies and shipping it to your or target environment or target machine, or you can say target servers. Let's say in this discussion, the target system may be QA's machine, or maybe it's a production machine. Okay, and if app worked in your local system, it should work anywhere in the world, because you have the same image and you are actually migrating the same thing in the different machine that is completely platform independent. If it is platform independent, then definitely issue arise. Okay, but it is completely platform independent. Okay, platform independent or dependent means you have, let's say, some OS, let's say Ubuntu, and someone has Windows operating system, and in the Windows they have multiple flavors, and in the let's say Linux we have multiple flavors like Fedora, Linux, or some, and someone has Mac. Okay, so image doesn't care what is the underlying operating system. it is completely completely independent of that. So that's why it is called a platform independent. And by taking advantage of Docker's methodology for shipping, testing, and deploying code quickly, you can significantly reduce the delay between writing code and running it in the production, actually, because the real challenge occurs when you are actually shipping your image from one host to another. Same code you are actually moved from one host to another host. Okay, so Docker simplifies the overall methodology and allowing developers to create templates called images, using which we can create lightweight and virtual machines called containers. And Docker infrastructure actually, isolate the application, maintain the consistency, and improve the resource utilization. So these are the things that Docker actually helps shipping software from, machine A to machine B, as I already told. And it is quite reliable and automatically done, and long setup time. So this is one time setup. Means developer do the all kind of setup, create a setup environment. And you can say in the current industry scenario, the term is called DevOps, development plus operations, the guy who actually does the both things, deployment plus coding. Okay, that profile is called as DevOps. So that do such things. Okay, so it actually, it's not like you are a developer and you just focus on coding. So you should know each and everything, like how it deploys, how it actually scale. There are a lot many things that you going to understand later on in this session. Okay, so what are the more problems and different dev test prod and this actually solves, and dependency matrix hill, virtual environment. One is dependency matrix hill, what it is. Okay, so dependency matrix hill is so the word containers come from very ancient time when there is problem in migration of resources from one place to another place, or you can say from one country to another country. Let's say I have to export some X item, or you can say I'm going to export something like animals, or let's say a good, or let's say something else. You can say cotton or some grains and food, something like that. So every item has separate ship, okay? And so there is a problem that in that time, okay, ship are limited for every item, and there is some scarcity. I mean, sometimes ships are, overutilized, or sometimes it is underutilized, because it actually works for exporting certain items only, not other than that. Okay, so what happens here is at that time the word come into the picture, that is containers, that actually containerize or packed your something like this. This is the containers, packed your items, whatever you are going to export from one country to another country, and the ship remains the same for every container. So it's quite easy to migrate resources, or you can say migrate goods, or you can supply without delaying or without worrying about whether our ship is overutilized or underutilized, because every ship are well-known compatible with all the items, because all the items are packed under containers. So that's the concept taken by the industry and termed as containers. So containers does the same thing. It actually packages your application and all the necessary dependencies and configuration in a one place, or you can say it creates an artifact that is called image. Okay. And the running instance, or you can say the environment that Docker does. So Docker run the image, and that image or that environment create after running the image is called containers. Okay, you can say running instance of an image is called containers. So images, what images are, first deep dive into image, what it actually is, what this thing is. So image is basically read-only template with some instructions for creating Docker container, simple term. Okay, so this is some instruction that actually helps in creating containers. And often an image is based on another image with some additional customization. For example, you may build an image which is based on Ubuntu image. Okay, so whenever you are going to create an image, so it's a layered concept. Okay, so you have some another image you are actually importing from somewhere else. Okay, and that layer image, but and let's say you want to install Apache web servers in your, since you are Dockerize everything, so you actually use the existing image. Let's say you want to host your application on Apache web servers, Nginx, there are a lot many web servers where you can host your application. Okay, and that hosting also you want to perform, you want to do in your containers. Let's say you want to package all those things in a container so that there is no need for separate hosting of Apache or Nginx in some another host altogether. Means there is no need to do the same again and again. So you pack all the hosting things in the application itself. How it we will perform, we will see later on this slide. Okay, so yeah, so it actually use the another image as well. So the configuration details needed to your application to run. So you might create your own image, or you might only use those created by others and publish in a registry. Registry means somewhere where every images are resides. Okay, that is called in the, that is actually a Docker Hub, and there are lot many private registry come into the market that is provided by cloud service providers like AWS, Google, and GCP, Microsoft Azure. Okay, they are the good players in the cloud provider service. So they actually provide their own private registry. So to build your own image, you create a Docker file, simple syntax for defining in the image. When you change the Docker file and rebuild the image, only those layers which have changed are rebuilt again. This is the part what makes image so lightweight and small and fast when compared other virtualization technology. So this is one, this is also a part of virtualization, means this is also called as virtualization. Container, what it does, it actually creates a virtuality, means it creates its own environment like we does in our, you know, virtual machine, right? You can say a virtual machine like I forget the virtual machine name, but some are very well known term virtual machine that we usually use to basically test few items. Let's say we want to prevent our actual OS to I want to stop my OS basically ki corrupt na ho. Let's say I don't want to corrupt my original OS, so what I can do, I perform any other, let's say I want to install some tools or do heavy operation, do some load testing or something. So I don't want to do in our actual operating system of our system, right? So that's why we create a virtual machine and do all those things there. And whenever it is done, we simply terminate all those, means we actually delete the virtual machine. Okay. So yeah. So first I'm just brief about containers because we heard so many terms about image and all. So it's simple, as I said, it's a running instance of image done by container. So overall containers life cycle, it means you actually come to in the later slide, we will first summarize all what our containers is. So it is artifact, easily shared and move around, and it actually makes the development and deployment more efficient. And you can say a container is a standard unit of software that packages up your code and all its dependencies, so the application runs quickly and reliable from one computing environment to another computing environment. So a Docker container image is a lightweight standalone executable package of software that actually includes everything needed to run an application like code, runtime, system tools, system libraries, and configurations. So a container is a runnable instance of an image, and you can create, start, stop, move, or delete containers using the Docker API or CLI. Means Docker is a tool which actually manages the overall life cycle of the containers. So you can connect a container. So a container is something, in a layman term, it's an environment where your application run. If your application run, then only you can serve the request of clients, right? So it's a layman term that is an environment, okay? A simple environment that actually created from your application and it's their dependencies. And so you can connect a container to one or more networks, attach storage to it, or even create a new image based on its current state. So by default, a container is relatively well isolated from other containers and its host machines. You can control how isolated a container's network, storage, or other. So whenever you run an application, okay, so your application needs some resources, right? And what are those resources? That is provided by your underlying system resource. That is nothing but your CPU, RAM, your storage, secondary storage, primary storage, that is RAM, and your input output, like whatever the IO you are performing, your application is performing, and whatever the network calls it made. Actually, network is also, we need to evaluate network as well, okay? So every system or host has the limitations of those resources. Means every system has fixed amount of CPU, RAM, whatever the resources is. So we have couple of resources that is mostly we are familiar with, that is CPU, RAM, GPUs, IO. GPU is actually used in machine learning, and input output, and you can say network, file system, something like that. So these are the resources that is actually Docker does isolations. So what happened earlier, every machine, so every application shared the same resources, right? So there is no one who actually stops, hey, you have this limitation. So one application always impact the another application. That is the most problems occurred in previous time, okay, very early days. That's why virtualization come into the picture. That's why everyone creates their own virtual machine and run. So one virtual machine correspond to one application. So we have dedicated resources. We allocate the, all the resources to it, like same CPU, RAM, whatever it is. And we have all the dedicated resources, and every application runs in the, in its own environment, okay? So yeah, so actually I go beyond something, because this things is very important to understand what Docker actually does, what is virtualization is, from where was this terms Docker and containers come into the picture. So that's why virtualization is very important to understand why there is need of virtualization. Due to this issue only, resources, shared resources, okay? So one application means that there is shared resources. So every application use the same underlying resources. What is underlying resources? Where, let's say your application is hosted on your friend's machine or your own machine. So that machine is actually, that application use the resources from that machine only, okay? And maybe it hosted on some server. Server is nothing but a remote machine, okay, that is provided. You can create your own server, or you can make your own machine as a server. And also you can take AWS and some cloud service provider to create your own servers, okay, server machine basically. And okay, so that is the thing that containers actually, virtualization solves. It limit the resources. Means every application has the boundary. Hey, you use 1 GB and one core CPU only. You have, let's say I have an application that use the resources extensively, let's say 8 GB of RAM and 16 or 4 core of CPU. So I allocate that much resources to that application. So it's good concept that every application works in its boundary only. So container is also, so in very technical terms, you can say container is a layers of images. I already mentioned that. Let's say you have an application uses web servers like Apache and underlying OS image, like lightweight OS image like Ubuntu. Okay, definitely without lightweight OS, you can't run any application, right? So you have to import some lightweight OS to your image. Okay, you can see in the practical session, definitely. So layers of images means a container consists of so many layers, and only that particular layers are going to update, which is actually have changed. Remaining things are as it is. So it's quite easy to deploy your overall containers, or you can spawn your containers in a fraction of seconds. Means spawning a VM is actually taking a minute kind of time. Okay, now there are lot many optimization is done in the real scenario. Optimization is there in virtual machine as well, called as micro VMs. Okay, so that is different concepts. Okay, so this is about containers. So just brief about what Docker image and what is difference between Docker containers. So the actual things, the actual object or package is called image, and that is actually moved from one machine to another machine, and it is not in running. Okay, that is called image. And container is basically whenever you run your application, run your image, that is called container. So you have to basically container is actually is in process, you know. Something is in your drive, right? But it is not in process. That is called code, right? And your program is under execution, is called program is on in execution, is called process, right? So Docker is nothing but container is nothing but is a process of your machine. Some similar, you can kill your process, you can spawn your process, something like that. So it's not a rocket science, it's simple a process. Okay, but it has certain features, like it can limit your resource, it can create its own boundary like that. Okay, so yeah, so very obvious thing is, like you can say every time a question arises, everything is taken care by virtualization, then why choose Docker over it? It might be because virtualization does not turn out to be efficient and idea. So virtualization means, I mean to say, hypervisor based virtualization. That is, this is the hypervisor where, okay. So this is the very detailed level discussion. I don't want to go right now, but the thing is, if the simple term is, if this exists, VM virtualization already exists, then why Docker? Why Docker is the means? What is the role of Docker? And if industry already use this VM, then what is the role of Docker, and why we are actually replacing a virtual machine with Docker in our current scenario? And you don't believe Docker or containers is actually used in the industry for lot many purpose, not only the existing problems, but actually the resource limiting, scaling, lot many things. Because if you want to spawn a new node altogether, I'm just taking an example. Let's say before jumping into this topic, virtualization versus containerization. So let's say you have an application that actually can serve 10 concurrent requests. Okay, so it means parallelly 10 users can access your application application. Okay, and it very usual means it can actually serves those 10 requests very easily parallelly. But problem here is, in the industry, there is no as such rule that 10 concurrent or you have to serve 100 concurrent. Like Facebook or Google, millions of people are accessing the Facebook servers and Google server. It's not like you have just 10 or 1,000 requests. Maybe if you are a small scale industry, then maybe you have 10 to 100 parallel requests you may experience. But what if it's a million or trillion requests at a time, right? So you have, and also you can't allocate dedicated resources, right? I have make an application and hosted on 1 lakh servers that actually serves 10 lakh of requests parallelly. That's a humongous cost, very costly thing it is to spawning so many servers or spawning so many virtual, you can say images, okay, not images, sorry, so many hosts. Host is nothing but you can imagine as a your machine, okay? So for let's say you're building an application and you want to serve 100 parallel requests. So let's say one machine can serve 10 concurrent requests, okay? So 10 machines can serve 100 requests very easily, right? So let's say you bring your friend's PC as well to jointly serve the request. And on top of, there is a load balancer who would actually talk with the client, and load balancer internally distribute the workload among the different nodes. Means different machine, maybe your friend's machine and your machine, it is. So the problem here is you have dedicated system, right? You have to have serve those requests, you should have a dedicated system. But problem is let's say we have suddenly spike of 1,000 requests. You can't bring 100 or 90 more hosts, right? 90 plus 10 is 100. 100 cross 10 means every machine actually serves 10 requests. So it means for serving 1,000 concurrent requests, concurrent means exactly parallel, means at the same time, okay? So you can't bring 100 machines, right? So the industry is actually quite often with this thing. Let's say in day scenario or in some scenario or in normal scenario or average scenario, let's say they have 10 machines. They require just 10 machines. So they only use 10 machines. But question is how they are able to serve millions of trillions of requests, okay? So that's why industry opt containers very, means you know, it's a huge change in the industry that for scaling, or you can say for scaling your infrastructure, containers play a very good role. Earlier, it was done through virtual machine. For example, let's say you have 10 hosts and now you want 100 hosts suddenly due to serving the spikes or traffic. Okay. Either you can make your system down. No, I can't serve. Sorry. Or if your system is 24/7 available, zero downtime, or you can say 99.99% available, then you have to have a good scaling power. Means your system should be scalable. Okay. Their containers come into the picture because container can spawn, okay, your node, new node, very frequently. Means it can easily add up immediately. It spawns within a fraction of a second. Let's say I have to spawn 100 simultaneous nodes, so I can spawn 100 containers immediately. Means it's matter of seconds. Okay, maybe clients' request is in queue for certain period of time. That's why you face some delay sometimes. Okay. So coming back to the topic, virtual machine versus, so this is the problem, right? Virtual machine can't solve this problem for now, but introducing of micro VMs can much the same thing that actually means somehow it actually solves the problem. But for now, everyone is actually using containerization for this purpose. So the operating system supports of virtual machine, Docker container is very different. So Docker container, virtual machine is completely different thing. So in but both are rely on the same thing, virtualization. Okay, same class of virtualization. So you can see each virtual machine has its cached operating system. If you see, every virtual machine has its cached operating system, means every system has their own cached OS. Means, let's say you have 100 of VMs. So you every VM should have separate operating system layers. And that is why they should lightweight. Okay, sharing the host operating system between containers, okay, make them very light and helps them to boot up just a few seconds. So containers actually shares the same resources. Okay, means it actually just load or boots up. Boots up means the program that is run in the initial phase. Let's say when operating system loads, some programs are actually running. That's why you are able to see your desktop and so many UI interface. That is called boot up thing. So yeah, so let's say you have it actually boots up so fast in a matter of seconds, because it does not require any separate operating system to host. So Docker engine actually take cares of all those things. Let's say I want to spawn a container. Okay, so I just tell Docker, please provide one container. It actually provide me container in a matter of seconds. But if I tell hypervisor is nothing but it actually isolate your resources, physical resources at hardware level. Means hardware level pe ye resources ko allocate karta. So let's say cloud services have lot many resources. How they are able to provide certain EC2 instance or certain servers to one particular organization or certain servers to another particular organization. So how they are actually isolate their resources. So through hypervisors, they are actually able to do that thing. So yeah, so Docker is actually boot up in a very, fraction of a second, because it just includes the app layer and your libraries, or you can say dependencies, okay? And Docker engine does all those things, but in the virtual machine, it actually boot up so slow because it actually first installed the operating. Everyone is familiar here, I guess. They are actually used to with installing operating systems in their machines. It takes time, right? Earlier it been a long means it actually takes lot many time, but nowadays due to we have sufficient resource to host an operating system, so it's quite fast, right? Earlier it is not like we have TBs of something cores of 8 or 10 cores of CPU or something like that. We have very limited resource at earlier. That's why it takes lot many time. So Docker containers are suited for situation where you want to run multiple application over a single operating system kernel. Okay, so yeah, that is the thing. And so couple of things that you should know, like in terms of security, which one is better, virtual machine or Docker. In terms of portability, like if you want to move from one to another host, which one is there, which one is good in terms of performance, which one is better. So coming back to the security, so the virtual machine does not share operating systems, virtual machine, this one. And there is a strong isolation in the host kernel. Hence, kernel is nothing but operating system has a program that actually provides the resources. Resources means hardware level resources. It talks to the hardware and provides the resources to new programs. Okay, so that program is called as kernel. Okay, that actually acts as a middleware between your hardware level and your operating system. Okay, so hence they are more secure as compared to containers. A container has a lot of security risk. Yeah, this is the disadvantage of Docker or containerization. So risk and vulnerability, as the containers have shared host kernel. Okay, and also since Docker resources are shared and non not now namespace and attacker, and basically attacker can exploit all the containers in a cluster. If see, let's say if he managed to get the access to even one container, so it actually access all those resources inside the host machine. So that is the disadvantage. In a virtual machine, you don't get direct access to the resources, and your hypervisor are there to restrict the uses of resources in a VM. So yeah, portability, in terms of portability, so Docker containers are very easily portable because they do not have separate operating system, and a container can be ported to a different OS. And yeah, so in our college day, so when I go with the theory, some maybe most of the people I think of ki college maybe theory padhate aur yahan bhi he starts with theory. College theory is actually helps you in exploring. Basically, it actually helps you in you can be a good system, or you can say computer engineer, if you have a good basics. If you don't have good basics, you are not able to think in terms of resources, memory, in terms of allocation processes. So you have to be good in basics, right? So in the industry, you won't get such time to go through the basics again. Okay, program is just it's just 10% of the overall project life cycle. The main challenge here is how you architect, means overall SDLC life cycle. It's just 10 to 15%. Writing a code is just, if you are, I'm not demotivate you, but the thing is you have to be good in basics first. Then you can explore program, write your code, think, and like Docker is a tool, right? Somehow some another tool we have that is called DevOps tools. So every tools has their own significance. So you have to be good. You have to be think practically, right? For which use case this particular tools is better, and for which tools is nothing but a software piece. Okay. So you should be good at like basics. Then only you come to know, okay, for this particular use case, we go for this container. Maybe your application is hosted on bank side. You can't use containers, right? Because they are mainly focused on security aspects, right? So I also works on financial institutes. So we can't use containers there, right? But but for the things that let's say we want to scale, or in a massive scale, some products we have that need scaling where we use containers. And for initial setup, we use containers. Let's say for QA process development, we use containers for that. But yeah, so coming back to the portability, Docker containers are very easily portable because they do not have the separate operating system. A container can be ported to a different OS, and it can actually start immediately. So on the other hand, virtual machine definitely have separate OS, so porting of virtual machine is very difficult as compared to containers. And it also takes a lot of time to port a virtual machine because of size and so on and so forth. So for development purpose, where the application must be developed and tested in different platform, Docker containers are the ideal choice, means by default choice is containers. So in terms of performance, obviously containers has a good performance. So comparing virtual machine and Docker containers, you would be fair because they both are used for different purpose, but the lightweight and architecture of Docker and its less resource, we come to the architecture and its less resource intensive features makes it a better choice than a virtual machine. So as a result of which, containers can start up very fast compared to that virtual machines, and the resource uses varies depending on the load or traffic, as I mentioned earlier. So yeah, unlike the case of virtual machine, there is no need to allocate resource permanently to the containers. So scaling up and duplicating the containers also an easy compared to that of virtual machine, obviously. So as there is no need to install and import, operating system from the scratch, right? So this is about Docker container, difference between Docker and its virtual machine. So this is the couple of points that actually you can go through this. It actually, I cover all those things in this. So yeah, so containers are basically, these are the features of containers. One second. Okay, so containers are lightweight, portable, self-sufficient. We already covered those things. So we already talk about so many things before containers, what are the lives. So installation process is very difficult. Many steps where should go wrong, right? So it's very tedious to debug the things earlier when we migrate our application from one host to another host. So what are the things before application? Okay, so this is configuration on the servers. So let me tell you the overall operational process, what happened. Okay, so how earlier all those processes going on. Let's say you build an application, what are the next steps? Okay, so basically whenever you build an application, you create a jar file. Maybe you worked with let's say you worked with Java, then you create a jar file. If you worked with Python, you create a binary file, okay, that is called PYC, and you actually give it to operational team with certain steps of process written in something like GitHub mein readme.md file is there. So you actually write all those process. This is the step number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up to 10 you need to follow, and this is the resources you have to deploy. Okay, operational team takes those, actually take those textual guide, and sometimes they understand, and they sometimes there is a conflict between understanding between developer's guide and the operational team guide. Operation team is nothing but they are administrator who actually takes the role of, let's say we want more servers, okay, so they are actually spawning new servers, or let's say if you want to host something, they are actually take our application and host into the production system or test or dev, whatever the stage we have. So yeah, so this is it. And life after container is very sorted. It's a very automated process, and it's on isolated environment, packaged with all the needed configuration, and actually one command to install the app, right? Means just you have to do, means you just see in the later session that how it is when you package your containers. Once you dockerized containerize your application, then just a matter of one command, you just fire and your infrastructure got spawned. Means yeah. And yeah, so anyone has any query for now? No? You can unmute yourself if you have any query, or we can have a separate session of QA. You can write your questions. We can separately answer each and every query in that session. Okay. So after containers, developers and operation team are worked together, create a separate guidelines, or do, means there is no conflict, they know the standards, right? Okay, I just need to fire one command, that's it. So this is it. So coming to the practical sessions now, I'm actually going Docker architecture after some practical sessions, so that you have a better clarity about the overall things that is running on. So my question is first key, where do container lives? Okay, so mainly where it resides, maybe in some repository or something, maybe in your host machine, let's say you want to run an image, Docker run something. If what if image is not available in your host machine, right? So whatever the base image means your, let's say your lightweight OS image, your lightweight, your web server image, whatever you use, right? That should reside in your host machine, right? Else you are not able to access. But this problem actually solved through registry, where we actually push everything in a set or maintain everything in a central repository. Okay, that is called as in Docker. Docker provides a Docker Hub tool that actually creates repository. Let's see in our, yeah. So when you go to Docker Hub, just type Docker Hub. So you have dockerhub.com. So I already have login. So it actually, so whenever you want to push or pull an image, okay. So if it is from public source, there no need to have your, you have, and it means if I want to run Docker run Ubuntu, okay. So I can directly fetch those images directly without any logging. So that image or that, images are actually publicly available. That's why you are able to pull. But let's say you are maintaining your own repository. You have your own project. You don't want to make it public, or maybe your company project. So you have to create your account in Docker Hub. Okay. So this is the account where first, this is the sign up process you have to face. So you need to put some Docker ID, your email ID, password, I'm not sign up, that's done. You just have to do a email verification, means go to your email and just click on verify, that's it. So there is an email pop-up inbox. So you just need to verify. So you are done with sign up, okay. So let's say I want to sign in with my account. I already have created a sign on my account. So whenever I want to push or pull image in my repository, okay, so I have to have login to the Docker, okay, else I can't able to push or pull any image. So this is my Docker Hub repository, and some, let's say you want to find Ubuntu, okay, so this is the Ubuntu image. Where you see 10 million plus downloads, and any image you can, let's say you work on MongoDB, okay, you have the MongoDB in the as an image, so you can directly pull and use those images, okay. So in the tomorrow session you are able to get how you interact with MongoDB and all. If you have means it's not required to have basics with MongoDB for now, because we are just use Mongo Express for UI interface. Okay, so this is it, and let's say you want Redis. So yeah, this is Redis image. So Redis is nothing but, let's say you want to store some data for temporary purpose. So but Mongo database is actually, so Redis and MongoDB has both it. MongoDB actually store your data in your secondary memory, and Redis store your data in your primary memory, or you can say RAM. So whenever you flush, or maybe your system get down, or maybe your terminal or process kill somehow, it actually clear all the memory. So it is temporary, but MongoDB is, or not MongoDB, any database is actually resides your data in some sort of, permanent storage on some file system. So whenever you come again, log in again to your system, you are able to see the data because it resides in the same place. So all the images are available in Docker Hub. Okay, and so this is private repository like that. You, whenever you click, you have select private or public. Okay, you have the option. Yes. Whenever you create an account, you can create a repository where you can have private, public, like that. And so what happened Docker Hub, how it actually works? Okay, so whenever, let's say, two guys, Rohan and Suyes, actually push an image to Docker Hub, so basically how they actually exchange their image, okay, so they can either push through or they can manually transport there through, you know, pen drive or your servers. Let's say they can put on some server, and from that server, that is central, that is accessible to both, they can pull from there itself. So Docker Hub is already created a separate server where you can push and anyone can pull the image. Okay, so through that they are able to access their images, each and other image, okay, through push and pull concept. So before jumping to the practical session, demo session, we have to have Docker installed in our system. So in the Google, whenever you type something like Docker installation for, let's say your system is Windows, so you can write Mint Windows. In my case, it is Ubuntu. Okay, so I type Ubuntu. So very first link is by default Docker official page. You can go there and you can directly install there itself. So this is the commands that you need to fire on the terminal. So this is the terminal interface of Ubuntu. So yeah, so first you need to install the Docker agent. Okay, so yeah. So this is the overall install, CentOS, Debian, Fedora, Ubuntu. There are a lot many flavors of Linux here. And yeah, so first it wants to uninstall old versions. Why it is, anyone have any idea why they want to uninstall if there is any older version? So the reason behind is the main purpose of Docker coming to picture is want to ensure there is no older version so that they won't any conflicts. But maybe due to Docker installation, mehi thoda conflict aa gaya, it creates a bad impression, right? That's why they want to remove older version. So if you check Docker -- version, sorry, so there is no Docker install in my system. That's why it asks for sudo snap, means give some suggestions, but don't follow the suggestions blindly because it creates some sort of problems because systems suggest something, but in the official documentation, there is something else written to avoid conflicts. Okay, so always follow the standards or documentations, whatever it is. So there are two ways to set up the installation. Either you can pull the package from the repository and install, and another way is through a script. Directly run the script, it actually install all those things. A script is taken care about your versions and everything. So that's why we go with script. So going to the script version is actually mentioned here. So this is the docker.get. Sorry. So Docker already create a path, get.docker.com. Directly you can get the, if this is shell script, you can directly run, shell script very easily, right? We can run shell script by just sh. So everything, if you see the code, okay, we don't go through the code, but definitely if you see the code, it actually have lot many if else conditions here. So it actually taken care of your environment. Okay, what it is, what is your underlying version is Ubuntu. Let's say I have Ubuntu 18.04. Somehow, somewhere we have Ubuntu 20.04, something like that. So it takes care of all those things. But you don't need, you don't worry about doing copy paste. You just go to the curl command. So you through curl command, you can actually request to a server and through your terminal and get the things. Let's say in this server, this content is hosted. Okay. So you can directly get the things from get.docker.com through this command. Okay. Let's say you want to, data from some other website, you can use curl directly. So if it is some, you know, without security, so it is not asking for authentication, right? So it won't ask for any authentication. So this is directly accessible. So you can directly use curl, not an issue. So I just use copy. So yeah, this is get.docker.sh. This is the file. If you see, like, is it visible now? So yeah, this is the get.docker.sh. So you can run sh. This is the way we can run our shell script, right? Sh space file name. But since it has some system related dependencies, so it, you have to use sudo for that. It requires sudo access. Okay. So it is actually installing our Docker in my machine. This script take care of everything. So coming back to the next, you can actually, it actually give a suggestion that if you add your user means, let's say, so this is my user, Karza, okay? So this is my user. And if you want to run your Docker commands or Docker CLI, okay, without any intervention of requiring system administration privilege, you can add your user to the Docker group. And Docker group actually take care or give the necessary permission. So without means it, I'm just taking an example. Let's say you want Docker want to check version. So this is Docker version. And let's say I want Docker PS. Oh, that is already added. Sorry. I already run this command. That's why it already add my user to the Docker group. Okay. That's why I'm able to use anything directly. Else I need to put sudo in front of every command, Docker PS, Docker something, anything, Docker images, something like that. Okay. So yeah. Let's talk about something. You are able to get the whole things, how you install. For Windows, you don't need to worry, just download this tool and next and finish. It actually asks for setting, just let it be default setting. This basically it asks for what sort of resources and all, how many resources you want to allocate. Doesn't write for the timing, you don't need to take in care of. Since my machine is not Windows, that's why I'm not able to perform this. But definitely you can download this tool from this link and directly install and run. And if you don't able to run Docker for now, so there is open source playground there where you can directly run this. This is given by Docker itself, or you can type in the, you know. A little bit. Actually, this takes a lot more memory, getdocker.com. So if you want to yes, so I'm talking about Docker Playground. Sorry, actually deviate. So if you type just Docker Playground in the Google, you have seen Docker Playground. You can start. It actually provide you instance or servers for the timing. You just click on add new and you can just play around. Docker is already installed here. Definitely they provide a playground. You can pull the image, like let's say you want to pull or you want to run some Hello World image. So this is very, this is actually very famous image, Hello World. If you see the Docker Hub, it has millions of requests for Hello World. It actually, this is the initial point of the Docker. When you start with Docker, this is the initial program that everyone actually tells you, because it actually tells you all the process, what happens internally. Docker generate the message, Docker client contact the Docker daemon. So in the architecture diagram, you are well known aware of this, what it is written over here. Okay, so this is about playground and installation. Coming back to, so we are already done with execution, and this is sudo. To remove sudo user, you have to run this command. Okay. And yeah, so this is the flow, Hello World, what it is, how it actually behaves. Let's say I'm just going to work on my system. So let's say I run Docker run. Run basically does is actually, run your image that is locally available. If it is not, it actually pull from your Docker repository or Docker Hub. Okay, so run is actually combination of pull plus, you know, start. So you can also use start. Okay, start your, let's say, Hello World. Okay, if you see, there is a command called Docker PS. It actually helps in listing all the Dockers currently running in my system. Okay, so currently I don't have any Docker running since I'm just install all the Docker. Process. Okay, so this is Docker PS command, and let's say you want to see if there any images reside in my Docker repository, means or in our local system. There is no repository or no images is running, right? No images actually resides in my local. So whenever I run Docker run Hello World, okay, so what it does is it actually first take unable to find image Hello World latest. So if you don't do any precision, like colon something, it actually by default pulls the latest image. Okay, so Hello World actually pull the image from the Docker Hub. You are able to see latest pulling from library Hello World. Library Hello World means it by default put this. Let me see Docker Hub. Sorry. Okay, so this actually by default Docker, when you say Docker pull the image, by default it goes to this server, and actually through this path it actually, sorry, where I am, yeah, so it actually pulls your request. So this, from this path it actually pulls the, you know, containers from the server. Okay, so Docker run first check local in my local system, then it actually pull, and then it actually do pull complete, give the message, or let's say if have it contains single layer, that's why it's not downloading each and every layer individually. So yeah, so this is it. So it actually download completed, and hello from Docker is the message that is written in the program to populate. This message shows that your installation appears, right? And if you run again, let's say, immediately displays the hello from Docker. Means you are now, means in your local repository or in your local system, the image and the process is already running. That's why you are, so run is actually not allocate in the background. So that's why you are not able to see. But if you want to see the images, okay, so you are able to see the image, hello world, latest. So tag means whether it is latest or whether it has some version. Let's say I have, I write a program and Dockerize that program, or let's say I write an application, build an application and Dockerize that application. So it's a good habit to put a tag, what version it is. Okay. So whatever the latest version, by default, you have to be tagged as latest. Okay. That's why if nobody specify anything, let's say when I pull Docker run hello world colon something 1.1. Okay. Means it actually request for that version. Maybe this version does not exist. You can see the different version in Docker Hub itself. Let's say I want to check hello world. So yeah, so it has only latest version, only latest, no version at all. But let's say if you go with Mongo, it has listed so many, sorry. So it actually has so many tags, means it is versions. So you, if you want to download, you have to basically either just use Docker pull Mongo, that's it. Or you have to specify the tag. Let's say your system is compatible with, maybe you run Mongo directly, maybe not with Dockerized. So you want to pull, okay, and install in your system, means attach with the system. So maybe your system is not compatible with some version, or maybe internally in the Docker Docker file, you have multiple containers or layers that is not compatible with each other. So you have to specify the this thing, version as well. Okay. So this is about Docker run. Coming to the slides, what next? So yeah, as mentioned, if you fire the Docker Hub, it actually go to the registry and then provides the image. So this is CLI. This is CLI, actually called as CLIs. That is client line interface. Okay. So whatever query you made, I am a client. Okay. There is a server. So Docker also works on client servers architecture. Means we are the client and we request from Docker server ki, hey, please provide this thing, please run this command, okay, run that command, okay. And Docker is very smart, you know, most of the things are done by daemon itself. So there is a daemon that is installed with your Docker ka repository. Let's say you are actually installed Docker, the daemon is also come with your package, okay, Docker package. So it actually locally put everything in your system. So daemon can be on one system, on another system. So we can't directly, as a CLI, as a client, we are not directly communicate with Docker. We communicate with daemon, and daemon forward our request. If it actually serves the request, then it actually look into the local and do the things. But if it is not able to see anything in the local, it actually requests to the Docker Hub server or Docker server, you can say. So this is the overall means broadly level architecture it is Docker. So the same thing is done here. So what is Docker ecosystem? So we are developer. So developer is actually just write application, right? Coding, that's it. So that's why everyone in the industry wants the developers should be in comfortable position. He should not be focused on something else like library conflict and like that. He should be purely focused on the business logic. So that's the work, or that is the role of developer. So he just whatever he have like code and everything, he just put all the instructions in the Docker file. That is the standard way it's not like the Docker file, main kuch aur likh raha hu and someone else sitting in the remote write something else. Okay, so yeah, so it is the standard format that Docker understands. So yeah, it actually develop and create a Docker image. So there are multiple steps. Okay, first you have to write an application that you want to host or dockerize or put into the production system. So you first write the application code, and then you have to put you have to write Docker file. Okay, and through Docker file you are actually create an image. Now image is created. Now you can do anything. Put the image on some another machine. Put the image on some repository. And put repository can be private or public. Okay, you can, if you think you can contribute on open source tools like Apache Foundation does lot many things to, means it actually have lot many developers that actually contribute to the project Apache Foundation. So through that, if you want to contribute that, you can put into the public, or if you want to maintain your own for your own sake of learning or own sake of, you know, for your industry, you create a private repository and push everything there. So that is Docker Hub. And through Docker Hub, you actually pull the image, and you can, this is the staging environment and this is test environment. Okay. So yeah, so this is, you can say, you can pull the same image in the first test environment, test everything is working. And if there is something gap or developer misses, you actually notify the developers. It actually fix everything in his code or his or her code. Okay. And then it immediately revamp the same Docker file again. So there is no need to, if he or she do some change in the code, there is no need to, create again new Docker file. Sometimes you have to create new Docker file, but most of the time you just rebuild the image. Means, let's say your image app one, okay, have version 1.1. Now you named as app version 1.2 and put in the Docker Hub or repository, and from there directly your servers actually pull those images and create the containers and host there. Okay, so this is the overall ecosystem and this is the high level architecture. So before going that, we have to just first understand with the, basic commands, like how to do that, how to do, then we actually jump for the application, host our own simple sample application. So I'm going to do that only. First, I create a, mkdir demo, let's say. Okay. So I'm just create a simple script, simple Python script that actually pings the some site, let's say Google or something. Let's say I create a script Subl. My script name is, let's say, Google ping.py. So whenever you write anything like in Python, you give the extension as py. So this is the Subl file that is open. So I'm just going to write a code. So let's say my site, my application continuously ping the Google server. So while true, if you want to specify some time, you can write the time key. If it is something greater than this, then only till that time you ping. Okay. So yeah. So for pinging, we use requests module for Python. That is request.get is used for pinging. Okay. You can give the URL. Let's define the URL here. URL is https://www.google, or you can say dockerhub.com. We can ping anything. Okay, let's start google.com. So this is the URL. Now you put the URL here, and so yeah, this is the content that actually given by URL. So this is the actually request object. First I print the request object, then so get the request object, and then in the request object I'm just printing the content. Okay, Google content. So through this format, so request, I want content, so there is a method called content. Okay, see small, you can get the content. Okay, so while true actually continuously ping or bombard the Google server, and Google server may block because they are very intelligent. So we put some time gap, time dot slip, so that my program wakes up on every 2 seconds and execute again and again. Okay, so here two things are required. One is a request that is not defined, so we are actually, this is the by default library given by Python, and time. Here time is there, that is not defined, so we have to import time as well. So this is the very simple program that you can put it in the method ping Google, something like that, kind of you can do that. Let's do that stuff. Dev ping Google. So while true, I actually every time ping Google. So this is the method. You can write this way or any way you can. The matter is, you need to host this in the, or we need to dockerize this. This is our whole. So first we have to check whether this is working or not. So Python Google, this is the command. You can run Python. Python is, and I want to recommend one thing, being a experienced developer. So you can start with Python in for the coding, but the thing is, you are not get the whole concepts like memory, RAM, how actually memory allocated. If you declare some variables, you might not get those concepts. So I highly recommend to start with C language. Okay, if you are a beginner, okay, or if you are already professional, and maybe so you start with C language, then but for coding, use Python only, because it's a Python or Ruby. These are very user friendly, or you know, developer friendly. Means in a very minimal lines of code, you are actually executing the things. So I highly recommend to go with Python. It actually builds the interest, because in our college days we don't have the interest in coding, right? So yeah, the same goes for me, and I build my interest to Python only after my in my industry only. So yeah, so that's the recommendation. Start with Python, go with HackerRank, solve some problem, build your problem solving skills. At least program one script in a day, solve at least one problem in a day, not sit on just one problem, and spend some half an hour, then go with solution. Don't directly jump to the solution. So this is the way you can build your problem solving plan and easily clarify the interview rounds and build your concepts like that. So this is the thing. So yeah, it's quite easy and easy to code, right? So just Python, my file name. This is my file name. Okay, Google already blocked me. So let's use some another website, because I already ping Google so many times, I guess. Let's ping Docker Hub. So this is the content of Docker Hub. First change the name. It's not the best ways. Place of Google and place Docker. So this is working, right? So, okay. So this is the, obviously this is the source page you are actually getting whenever you are, you go with, go to dockerhub.com. You can see the source page from the, from there itself. So this is the view space source. This is the source that you actually see here. Okay. You can beautify, there are a lot many tools or Python libraries that actually beautify your overall things. Okay. So this is it. So now, so this is our script, and now we want to host this script. Okay. So first we have to create Docker file. Always remember creating Docker file, you have to give this only name, only that, that's it, just Docker file. Okay, create Docker file. This is the name, D with D caps. You can't use your own name. That is the restrictions. If there is some another thing that I already remind you, like if you are free to give any name, you can. But in this case, you have to have use only Docker file name. So just Docker file. So this is the Subl is the, you know, Sublime ka shortcut. I use editor Subl, okay, Sublime, okay. And this is the shortcut. You can directly open the file in the Sublime. So if you install Sublime, it is you can directly install from the Ubuntu store. This is the store where you can directly Sublime, install the Sublime editor here. So this is the Sublime text. For me, for my case, it is already installed. You just need to install, that's it, like this. This is not installed, that's it. And you are done. So just whenever you are working on something, Subl, do Subl. Or you can ping. For me, for my case, this is ping as a fabric. That's why it stay here. Okay. So, okay. So Subl Docker file, that is already open. Now I'm going to write some code, some script. How actually, so Docker file has some specific formats. Okay. So without that, you can't write Docker file. So you need to know the keywords. What are, so let's say you want to install, or you want to import some another image, baseline image. In our case, we have to, as I mentioned, we have to import some OS, lightweight OS to run any program, right? So that is already built or already provided by Docker Hub. So let's say you have Ubuntu as an image, Ubuntu. So this is the keyword from. So yeah, this is always in caps from Ubuntu. So if you see in Docker Hub, or you can, if you see here, let's say Docker pull Ubuntu. So this actually pull the latest Ubuntu. So it is available, right? So if you does not mention any version, it by default pulls the latest version. If you want to pull a specific version, you have to specify something like this. Right now I'm just pull the image, not run the image. Okay, that if you see Docker PS, so there is no process is running. If you see any earlier processes there, so yes, there is two process of hello world was running. So status is exited, matlab I already killed the program, and some by default scientist name are populated over here. You can give your own, specify your name as well. So I'm just going to write the Docker file first. Okay, so from Ubuntu I just import the baseline image, and then so from is actually used to set the base image. Let's say you want to import some another image for that, and run. If you want to run something, okay. So let's say, okay. So I just want to mention or highlight one thing here. Ki I use Docker ping, okay. cat docker ping. Okay. So in this case, I import two libraries, import request, import time. Time is already as a part of Python, wo kya, Python ka base image. So you, if you install Python, then time already come with your package, but request you need to explicitly install or mention somewhere. Okay. So the best way in the industry we follow is a requirement. We put requirements.txt. Okay. And or you can use Alpine as a base image rather than Ubuntu. But right now I focus on building from scratch. That's why I build first, import the base OS image, then I run manually. So you can also specify the requirements. Let's say you put in the requirements. In the tomorrow session, we will see with requirements. Okay. For now, we understand the basic things. Okay. So let's say I'm building Docker file. So we have to install so many things like systems update and upgrade, and also let's say Python ka pip you need to install, and one more thing, in the Ubuntu image, Python is inbuilt, means there is no need to install Python as a separate. So if I am new to OS, right, I'm not installing anything and I just check for Python, always I have, if anyone anyone can test this, okay, you have Python, definitely if you have Ubuntu image, then definitely it should run and you can do anything here, like if you want to use a string concatenation, let's say 9+ or something, you can do here. Okay, so yeah, so something like that. So from run, you have to specify what you want to do. Okay, so there are two things. One is run and another one is CMD. And so couple of things while running the application, you have to take in care of. One is your dependencies should be there. Okay, and another one is, so for me, Python 3 virtual environment, I already have created. That's why already in my, if you see pip fridge, I have already so many libraries here in my environment. That's why I'm able to run my program easily. But if I'm not running in environment or running anywhere, then definitely it asks for those libraries. Let's say I use request. If you see, you can actually, this is the tedious way to see all those libraries. You can grep. This is the Linux favorite command, requests. You can directly grep whether requests are there or not. Yes, it is. This is the request library that is already there in my system or my environment. That's why it is. It actually won't require request separately. I tell you how to create your own virtual environment, everything. Don't worry. I'm just dockerize my first command. So since you have to take care of, like, you have to start everything from scratch. Okay, so you have to put everything like Docker apt-get update, like this is the basic very familiar thing, right? Okay, whenever you update something, whenever you install some libraries, you have to make sure that the signature or the repositories, so Ubuntu has also a repository, it should have refresh his repository. So refreshing the repository, nothing but it's re-indexing its basically repository values, or Ubuntu maintains a index of every repository it has in the local system. So when you run sudo apt-get update, okay, so it actually re-indexing each and everything, basically it refresh something, then you can add some another thing and it actually it actually take care of everything like conflicts and all if everything is refreshed. So we every time whenever you install something, it's a good practice to update the repository list. Okay, and then you can one is this, and then you can run apt-get install. You have to install Python as well, so it is Python 3 in my case. because it is latest version Python 3. And yes, hyphen y is used for let's say it asks for confirmation. To skip those confirmation, you can use Python hyphen y. But since it's a Docker, okay, there's no one to manually enter yes, do take the confirmation. That's why we suppress those confirmation check, okay, whether you want to confirm or not. So that's why we use flag hyphen y, okay. And then we need to run. This is Python is installed, and Python we have to use pip packages. So Python actually pip is the repository where all the libraries, you know, like time, like I said, time and so many libraries are come with pip package. So we have to install pip as well. So we have to Python pip, it is already come, and Python is already there. Now we need to install request, okay, that we use, you know, here. It is open Google ping. So this is the request I need to install. Okay. So I'm going to put pip3 install requests. This is it. And then I need to copy, Docker creates one environment. So in that environment, it should copy something in his environment, right? So let's say I have command, I have a script or folder where all the scripts are there. So I have to have put into the, you know, Docker environment, right? So we need to actually run copy command for that. So run command is actually used to, while building the image, it actually run these steps. Hey, pip apt-get update, do apt-get install Python, do install pip3 install request. So if you see, let's say I am deactivate this environment. So if you see, if you want to install pip, if you can, requests like that. So this is already installed in my default as well. That's why it's seeing requirement already satisfied. And So copy command is used to copying files and directories from host system to the image. Okay. So yeah, copying your, let's say your Docker file is actually, go to demo. This is your Docker file where you actually run your command to build the image. So your in reference to Docker file, the file you want to add is docker-ping.py. It's just next to Docker file. So you can directly specify the name Docker. So this is the host path, and this is your source path. Source path means in the container, inside containers, you can also access the environment of containers if you are actually know. So this is the container path, and this is your host path, you can say. So the host path is nothing but current directory, that is Docker ping. So I directly copy paste this. Let's say if it is inside app, something like that. So I need to give app slash something. Or you can give the full path, no, not worry. But it is recommendable that in reference to Docker file, you have to mention each and everything. Okay. So currently in the local, copy all the folder. Let's say it is folder only. So you have to use app pura, app slash. Inside the app, you want to copy everything. So right now we have just Docker. And where you want, it is recommendable that you put everything in some folder. Let's say slash app slash, you want to name the same, let's say .py. So the Docker copy, it's in the root. So there is a root directory in the, if you know, in the Linux. So this is the root, right? If you see pwd, this is the root slash. So V resides on home, my username, my workspace, my demo folder. Here I resides, okay. But Docker actually works from the, its root. So every, let's say, in the, so basically every host, let's say Docker is actually starts from the root context, everything. So if you see, so whatever application you are going to host, it is not advisable to put in the root path. Anything you put in the root path, it is not advisable. It is advisable. It is if it is application, create a folder inside the Docker. Docker actually take care of everything. Let's say you want to put some folder name. Docker actually creates a folder on behalf of you and put the Docker ping there. Okay, while building the image. Okay, and finally, you can run multiple things, but there should be some entry point. For me, the entry point is something like this. Let's say I'm doing ls python docker ping. This is my entry point, right? So if in case of Python 3, we can use Python 3 or Python, doesn't matter at all. You can use Python 3 or Python. So this is the two line command. So this is two words command. So you cmd, this is the entry point. And in every Docker file, you always see the cmd, because you have to have specified the entry point by anyhow. Okay, so cmd, this is the command. Let's say I have multiple commands. I have two commands, right? So I have two text in the PA, Python 3 or Python, both works. And whatever the full path, you have to provide the full path. What is the path? Inside the Docker, now it is running in the environment, right? So you have to take, not taking care of the host system, you have to put the name according to your container. Okay, so this is the container path. So from there, it actually picks this ping, because already you copy here. Okay, and finally it runs the thing. So now Docker file is ready. So whatever things we are actually doing, everything we are listed, we install, we took the lightweight base image from the Docker repository, run the apt-get update to refresh the and install the Python pip with pip. Okay, Python is already come with Ubuntu, so there is no need to separately install Python, and we just need to install Python pip. Okay, that is the repository where Python actually maintains its library repository. And then we have a request, that since we use request, so we have to use pip3 install request. That is the command we directly, so this is run command, you directly use these things, apt-get update, you can directly. So in a Docker file, you can have multiple run command, but always have single cmd command. This thing, don't be confused, because in my starting day, I actually confused ki run command is also should be single, because it also performs some actions like cmd does. It also, if you see it internally, do the same thing, run Python 3, same thing, right? Because when you run this program, Python 3 docker.ping, this is the run command itself, right? This is the one of the command, right? So you can use this or this, but in Docker file, you must have provide the entry point. That's why you use cmd for the entry point. So yeah, this is it. Now we are going to do the final thing, that is creating image from the Docker file. Okay, so the syntax of building image is very simple. Docker build, and this is, we need to provide T. Okay, and so T stands for something like you can specify the name of the image. Okay, or by default, it takes its own name, random name, but it is advisable to give the name. So let's say I put Docker ping only. Docker ping. Okay. And want to include everything. Okay, so Docker file resides in the same current directory. That's why it's dot. Okay, if it is reside on some another reference, let's say it reside inside the slash some workspace folder, okay, and inside that there is Docker folder, so you have to mention dot slash workspace, that like that. So this dot means Docker file resides in the same current directory. That is this one. This is the current working directory. So I'm just wrapping everything. Build-t docker ping dot. But actually, if you see this, it actually perform in the layers, right? So first it actually import the base image from Ubuntu, running the apt-get, okay, everything. Then it actually, finally, it actually run the installation Python pip, okay? And then Python pip has lot many packages, local packages, and from the server also. So you can basically, it actually installs all the local packages. Like one of the thing is like, let's say you import time, right? So that is the local. So now it is installing Python pip. So it takes some time. Then you see the next line of statement is install request, and then copy, and finally cmd. This is the, yeah. So run pip3 installs request. Yeah. So I'm not mentioning any version. That's why it tags as a latest. If I mention something like this 1.1, it actually, so it is recommended to give tag. Okay. So now I am used to the images, Docker images. So you are able to see my image as well, Docker ping. Okay. A question is, how can I run this Docker ping? Simple Docker run command, right? Docker run and Docker ping. So it actually runs your program through Docker, right? And you can directly export this image and directly provide it to your any friends or colleagues or anyone. So this is actually pinging the Docker website, the Docker content. If you see, this is every 2 seconds actually pinging the Docker content. So this is working, right? So one thing I want to mention, like I actually have so many. So this is a basic practical. Okay, so now I'm going to explain you Docker architecture so that it is easier for you to understand what Docker high level architecture is, because whenever you go to interview or anything, you have the very first question is, if you mention something in your resume, how it works, why you choose this. You interview already know that you work with certain items, right? But he wants to know okay, how deep your knowledge is, and do you know the impact of it, and why this thing come into the picture, and why you use, let's say you use in project, you are not like, yes, I'm using Docker and my work is done, I'm putting it in resume, your job is done. No, you have to have clarify the interviewer that for this purpose I use Docker, because this actually fits to my use case, and this is, I actually perform a daily interview, almost 2 to 3 interview daily. That's why I know, okay, what kind of things interviewer expects from you. So if you mention anything on your resume, you have to know in which use case this particular tool or something, program or whatever software you use, okay, is relevant. Okay, so that's the thing. So you should know high level architecture diagram as well, okay, how it works, then only you are able to relate through your use case. Okay, so it's quite difficult to understand, and it actually won't help you for the time being, but it's good to know the architecture for any system. If you can understand just 20 to 30%, that is more than enough at this stage. Okay, So Docker uses client server architecture. I already mentioned above earlier. Sorry. So client servers means you actually first, let's say you are a client and wants to get some data from servers. Let's say you create Docker Hub. You want repositories, right? So you request for repositories or some image from that repository. So you request for that, right? So client servers is one client, and there is a server who actually serves those requests. First, you have to connect the client server. So client first sends the acknowledge packet. Hey, I want to connect. Once the servers connect with the client, it actually serves the request, and client continuously requests for anything. Okay. Then, this is client. There is client, and server could have multiple server and multiple clients. Many to many, is it? It is. So the Docker client talks to the Docker daemon. So as I mentioned, no any request goes directly to the Docker server. So everything is go as via Docker daemon, which does the heavy lifting or building, running, and whatever the Docker does. Means whatever the functionality of the Docker is performed by Docker daemon. Daemon, anyone is aware of daemon, what it is? You can unmute yourself and what daemon is? No? So daemon is nothing but a program. Okay, everything is a program, right, in the computer system. So yeah, it's nothing but a program, or you can say component, that continuously watching for something, right? Hey, let's say I manage Docker. Okay, whatever the request coming from the client, I continuously look for the client request. Okay, and whenever clients trigger something or ask for something, I immediately serves those requests. For example, let's say daemon is very popular in the computer system, where you actually if you are open this terminal, lot many programs are invoked. Everything is written here. If you see, this is not related topic, but it's very useful to understand. Okay, so I'm just open another terminal. So this is Bass RC. Okay, so this is the program. This is also a program, lines of command. Okay, written on Bass's shell script. Okay, so this program is actually invoke when you open the terminal. So whatever written here, I put so many shortcuts here, alias, something like that. You can also put the alias for your simplicity. Alias is nothing but, let's say I want to activate Python virtual environment, Python 3. I can activate 3 or tell activate 2, so that you directly jump to that rather than writing, you know, whole thing. So if I want to activate my Python 2 environment with Python 2.7 or plus, or Python 3, I have both. So I can just write activate 2, or activate 2 is for Python 2, activate 3 for Python 3. But if I genuinely activate Python 2, actually, so I need to write this command slash app where reside. I completely forget where my actual environment resides. So home Karja and Python, let's say 2 environment, bin activate is this is the full path of your environment, and this is the activate. So now you actually able to activate Python 2 environment. Okay, so this many commands you need to type, and you don't have to, like, let's say I want to connect to server something. So I just need, let's say I'm working as a in my company, I'm handling the batch processing. So I have batch server. So I just put batch and I am in the server. Okay. So this kind of shortcuts I write. So this is happened. Let's say this particular program execute as a daemon. Okay. So whenever you trigger something, whenever you open the terminal, it automatically triggers or execute the Bass RC commands. That's why I'm able to run any shortcuts. So that is the daemon. Okay, and so Docker actually client talks to the Docker daemon here, and which does the heavy lifting, building, running, and distributing our Docker containers. And Docker client actually, Docker client and daemon can run. So it actually, this daemon can be on the client machine or on the different machine. It for us, it is on the same machine. Docker, when you install the Docker package, the daemon come along with you, okay? And the Docker client and daemon communicates using a REST API. So everything is an API. Let's say you want to interact with Docker, okay? And you can't directly communicate with some other system, right? You have to create or build API. Anyone is know about API, what it is? You can unmute yourself and answer what API is, because it's very important to know about the API. And basically it's full, everyone is aware of application programming interface, that is its full form. It's not like never tell the API means any full form in the interview or somewhere. Every time you have to you have to tell the mechanism behind that. So yeah, so API is nothing but you can say it's a program hosted in the server machine, okay? And it actually, its main role is to serve the request. Let's say I'm in a very layman term, I'm just tell a story. Let's say a client goes to the server. Let's say a client goes to a developer, okay? Okay, hey, I want to add two numbers. Can you write a program for me? So developers can very easily write a program to add two numbers, okay? But when developers hand over those tools to client is very, there is lot many headache to clients. He says, oh, it's very difficult for me to set up all the infra. Means I should have Python and all. I have some sort of resources. I have to run somewhere, right? That program. So I need to set up those. I don't want to do that. Can you please set up for me? So again, by developer set up all those things to client machine. But again, client says, hey, I want to process some complex operation and want to add some complex number that is very big in number, and my resources means my system is not capable of doing that such kind of processing. So in that case, you know what does is simply if client machine is 1 GB RAM and 2 core or something CPU, it does not able to compute the processing. Entire computation is done in the client side itself. So client finally asked developers, can you give some sort of interface so that I can pass some input and get the response immediately without bothering about system setup and bothering about the resources. Whatever the things are, you have to take in care of this. So developers create an API and host those that program on the servers, and when client and give a URL to client. Hey, let's whenever you want to connect, you want to do some, just pass these two values or n number of values, and it actually automatically sum up all those things and give it the result to you. Okay, so yeah, so this is the so client. So every processing is done on server, means developers end or developers environment. Okay. Or maybe he's owning, or maybe he's something, he uses cloud car servers and all. So yeah, everything is done at developers and not the client. Client does not bother about the resource management and everything. He has just an interface. That interface is called API. Okay. So whenever client, Docker client is nothing but us, who is actually firing so many queries. Hey, please list down my image. Hey, please do such thing. Hey, please containerize. Please stop the container. Please run the container, and so on and so forth. So that thing is actually taken care through API, and the API is actually, so Docker client and daemon actually communicates using REST API. So they can't directly communicate because this particular host may be at some another machine. It could be, right? So that's why the only way to communicate is through API, because you can't communicate or get the data directly from another host. Yeah, it could be possible through TCP and all, but for in the case of HTTP or HTTPS, you have to request for any data through API only. Okay, so it actually communicates through, or there is a term called socket interface. You can use that as well to get those things. And another Docker client is actually, so coming back each and everything, what is Docker daemon, what is Docker client, and what is Docker registry? So the Docker daemon listens for Docker API every time. Like I said, it's a program that running continuously and listen for the something, whether something is coming or not. Is there any request? Okay. So Docker API actually listens to that and manage Docker objects such as images, containers, network. So everything is taken care by Docker daemon itself. Okay. And Docker client is nothing but the client who actually firing the queries. Docker build, hey, build the image. Docker pull the image, right? So that this is the things. And Docker registry is, as I said, Docker Hub is one of the example. So that are the components here. So this is all about Docker ecosystem, Docker high level architecture. So this we already done. Hello, Google app, do something like that. Already write Docker file. I already told you that Docker file is nothing but the blueprint of building images, right? It's a simple blueprint. Means you can say without Docker file you can't build any image. So for hosting any application you have to have Docker file, and that has proper syntax. If you can Google it, like what are the Docker file, how to write a Docker file. You can either Google it, or because since I am not able to cover each and everything, your use case or everything, right? I can host the simple thing and whatever requires. So certain keywords are there, like run, from, and copy, CMD, work, DIR. That is very common in every scenario. That covers almost 80% of your things. Okay, so you have to just know about its syntax. That is the most important thing. So yes, so and ordering is also matter. Let's say you directly run in the like that. Ordering is very important. Top to bottom approach, we have to, yeah. So this is very important that you have first OS, lightweight OS, Ubuntu image, then you install something like this, and then you can't directly put here CMD Python 3, right? Because there is no environment or setup built right yet, right? You can't build directly run app Docker ping because it needs some dependencies, and that dependencies comes from here itself. And another aspect is, in industry, it is recommendable that whatever the things are list changes, means बहुत कम change हो रहा हो, वो सब ऊपर रखो, जितना ऊपर रख सकते हो. इससे क्या होगा कि आपका जो Docker build होगा वो काफी fast build होगा, क्योंकि वो same image को reuse करेगा. Let's say आप code पे बहुत frequently change करते हो, obviously, right? तो उसको सबसे नीचे रखो आप, ठीक है. And dependencies तो definitely it should be there. बट जो फ्रिक्वेंट चेंजेस है उसको सबसे नीचे रखो, एंड जो एकदम कम चेंज होता है ना वो ऊपर रखो. इससे क्या होगा कि हमेशा जो लेयर बनता है वो टॉप टू बॉटम बनता है. ओके, सो इसमें लेट से आपने यू पुट इट ऑन द टॉप. ओके, लेट से ये चल भी गया बिकॉज इसमें लेट से सेल स्क्रिप्ट था, उसमें कोई डिपेंडेंसीज इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड. So this is shell script where it is something like SS file and it works. Okay. So what happened is, let's say if you want from Ubuntu, वैसे होता नहीं है, Ubuntu चाहिए ही, right? So let's say एक example दे रहा हूँ from Ubuntu, and ये and you actually change this here, right? since Docker works as a layer, okay, इसमें चेंज कर रहे हो तो नीचे के जो भी जहां भी चेंज हुआ है उसके नीचे का पॉइंट सब फिर से रिबिल्ड होता है. ओके, सो इट इज एडवाइजेबल दैट वॉट एवर द फ्रीक्वेंट चेंजेस शुड बी पुट ऑन द बॉटम. एंड जो बहुत कम चेंज होता है जैसे इमेज, ओएस इमेज, ये डेवलपर्स नहीं करेंगे, राइट? नेवर डेवलपर परफॉर्म दिस टास्क. एंड मे बी ये लाइन पे थोड़ा चेंज हो सकता है, लेट्स से दो चार फाइल्स और ऐड हो गए एप्लीकेशन में, तो इसको बॉटम में रखना. हमें सी एम डी तो हमेशा बॉटम में रहता है एंट्री पॉइंट, दैट इज बाय डिफॉल्ट, बट दिस प्रोग्राम कॉपी प्रोग्राम शुड बी ऑन द यू नो बॉटम बिकॉज दिस इज द फ्रीक्वेंट चेंजेस. अब नेक्स्ट टाइम क्या होगा, वेन एवर यू बिल्ड, लेट्स से आई जस्ट बिल्ड अगेन, यू सी इट एक्चुअली रीयूज द सेम थिंग. ओके, सो दिस इज फर्स्ट मेक श्योर वेन एवर यू बिल्ड ना Docker file should be there itself. यहाँ पे Docker file होना चाहिए and वहीं पे build करो. It's quite seamless अगर ऐसा हुआ तो. So Docker build dot it actually build immediately. It won't take any time, right? Because you know this is and if you see because it actually reload or reuse the same layers. क्योंकि what happen is whenever something is not there in your Docker Hub actually it pulls it and store in the local and अगर next time आप use करते हो तो फिर से वापस वो Docker Hub पे नहीं जाता, वो actually local से ही pick कर लेता है and local से if it actually picks from the local system it immediately picks from there. So yeah, this way this is all about Docker and the industry and standards that I already told. Ki what are the things that we need to take in care of. Now we are going to build some small application. Let me see the flow, what where we are. So yeah, if you remember, have you ever anyone know about Jenkins or heard about Jenkins? This is also a tool. Similar, not similar, it actually are DevOps tools of for CI/CD. CI/CD means continuous integration and continuous deployment. It means you continue to deploy something and there are a lot many changes happen. So you don't need to require any manual effort. Aisa nahi hoga ki aap image build kar rahe ho and you are actually basically put that image to Docker Hub or somewhere. And you actually run something again to deploy on another host machine. It is not like that. There is no manual effort. Once developer is confirmed that this thing is already done, okay? Matlab app is working fine, changes are already met. Developers just push those images on some repository and from there, it automatically picks by Jenkins and actually it deploy everywhere in the respective servers. It depends upon your configuration, obviously. So so Docker can also use as a replacement for Jenkins for a bit. So you can write a program that actually does same thing. So what developer does is developer just push the image and you can write a program that actually watch those whatever the latest file is. If there is some change happened, let's say I'm just taking an example, developer do some change, put into the Docker Hub, commit to Git, Jenkins take those image, okay, and it actually Jenkins actually check from the Git. So how Jenkins knows ki there is some change happen? Okay, it actually something is tell by version controlling system, that is GitLab, Bitbucket, something like that tools, where you actually push your code, whatever the latest changes. So Jenkins knows, oh, this is the change and I need to run all those deployment process. So it invokes your script, whatever you provide to it, Jenkins actually integrated with Git automatically and it actually and that script pulls the latest image and deploy in all the servers. Let's say you have 10,000 of servers, it automatically deploy all everywhere. So this is the beauty of overall DevOps pipeline and DevOps tools. सो यू डोंट हैव टू वरी अबाउट मैनुअल एफर्ट्स लाइक हे मेरा तो कोड हो गया अब मैं क्या करूँ, देर इज नॉट लाइक, और या फिर मैनुअल मीन्स डेवलपर्स शुड फोकस ऑन ओनली कोर लॉजिक, बिजनेस लॉजिक. वंस इट इज डन ही जस्ट पुश एंड दैट्स हिज वर्क इज डन. So that's the thing, and this is the command Docker directive. So from I already told about this from run copy cmd, and this is container lifecycle. So yeah, so whenever you create your container, you actually container is running, then you actually stop the containers, and you can pause the container as well, and finally kill. So this is very basic thing, like you can manage the container life cycle through Docker, as I already said, and this is the commands through which you can manage. Okay, certain commands that you already aware of, like Docker build and Docker starts. Okay, Docker starts, so we are not okay. So one thing is, let's say I have a file. Okay, let's say I'm just going Docker images to list all those images. So this is Docker ping, okay, and want to run Docker ping. So one is to run in the foreground mode, or you can run in the background mode. Okay, so in the industry we never run on foreground mode. If somehow terminal closes, it automatically shut down the process. So we always run our containers in the background mode only. Okay, so how you run the program in the background mode? Okay, so you can use hyphen d, that it means detached. Okay, so run Docker in the detached mode. You can see through example Docker run hyphen d. So it gives some process ID. Okay, so this is now running. I have to stop this because it continuously ping the Docker Hub service. So if you want to check the logs, you can check whether anything is running or not. Docker ps -a. Okay, it actually exists due to some error maybe.
Yes, I request to all, please fill the attendance form.
assignment as well, but focus on this first. Then we will two assignment I actually provide, and then we can go ahead with the solution in the first session or first part of tomorrow session with the solution and discuss the problems solution, and then we can go ahead with Docker Compose and understand the and actually create a full-fledged application. Also with full-fledged application that used in the industry, okay, and with Mongo database and persistent. So the Mongo database is not persistent there, so we are actually try to use volume concept of Docker used to persistent that overall thing. Means we actually store each and everything. Let's say we store name, everything of employee, right? So we are actually store in our volumes section so that DB remains, basically it's not temporarily available. So what happen is whenever you run Docker, okay, and terminate the Docker, all the persistent or whatever the layers inside the Docker, whatever the files, folders, everything is lost. So you have to persist in the host machine. That's why volumes come into the picture. We will see each and everything tomorrow. So tomorrow is very important session for each and everything. Okay. So that's it from my end. Thank you so much.
Hello. Yes. Yeah, sir. Whatever you are going to share with them, please share in the Google Classroom. So okay, these students will access it from there, even the assignment that you
understood.
Yeah, assignment. And if you are sharing some code or whatever you showed today,
yes.
If you could share this in the classroom, that would be helpful for them.
Okay, understood. Sure.
Yeah.
And classroom is accessible for them, right? Okay, fine. Thank you so much. And gather your queries. We will have a separate session for Q&A. We will see each and everything there. Thanks a lot for your time.
I think.
So we have officially come to an end of today's part of the workshop.
Just a minute. Participants, please note down the code for the Google Classroom. So I have put the classroom code in chat. Just note down this and enroll for the Google Classroom. So you will get all the material there itself. Yes, Riya, over to you.
So this marks the end of today's workshop. Thank you to Zafar sir for conducting the workshop so seamlessly. We are looking forward to the second part of this session. Participants, please remember that the same link for Zoom applies for tomorrow's meeting as well. And also please remember to fill today's attendance form as well as the feedback form. Hoping to see you all then, and I hope you have a nice day. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks everyone.
Thank you, sir.
The lesson took the